Hello everyone, welcome back. In this lecture, I'll be discussing about dual nature of radiation and de Broglie hypothesis. That means de Broglie waves or matter waves. Let us start. For electromagnetic radiation, we understand that the radiation behaves like a particles and waves. Now, what about electrons, protons, neutrons? Protons and neutrons, are they behaves like a particles? What are those? Are they particles? Please note down your answer on your paper and check yourself. As electron is a particle or a wave, neutrons and protons are particles or a wave. Then what about a material particles? Material particles means kind of football, cricket ball, you, me, objects, anything. Are we having a particle nature or a wave nature? Or dual nature? That's a question. This question stands until completion of 18th century. Now, this question is being answered by Louis de Broglie in 19th century. Here is de Broglie, Louis de Broglie. He is trying to answer this question. He understands that until now light is behaving like waves, but in the 1905, Einstein put forward a theory called Einstein's theory of light, in which Einstein proposed that light is behaving like a particles. And by using that theory, Einstein explained photoelectric effect. So from that onwards, everybody understood that light behaves like a both particle and wave nature. So in 1924, de Broglie also thought that why not material particles like electrons, protons, neutrons, material particles, other material particles like cricket ball, you, me, and everything. Everything can also have a wave nature. That is what is being proposed by Louis de Broglie in 1924. It's strange, right? How I will have a wave nature? How you will have a wave nature? How a cricket ball can have a nature? You know clearly electron has a mass and it's a particle. But how these electrons, protons, neutrons have a wave nature? It's strange, but this thought actually changed the entire world. Let's see what is this. De Broglie proposed a hypothesis. Here he thinks that it turns out that everything is a kind of mixed together at the fundamental microscopic level. That means he says that nature is a symmetric. It has a both wave nature and particle nature. Everything is a mixture of both particle and wave nature, and the entire universe is filled of both matter and radiation. That means the entire universe is completely is considered of both particles and wave nature, and also the matter and radiation exhibits wave nature. Every material particle is also exhibits a dual nature like a radiation. The radiation is exhibiting a dual nature. Similarly, every material particle also exhibits a dual nature. And if at all, if it is a wave, then what is its wavelength? That's obviously the question will rise. The wavelength of the wave is given by lambda is equal to h by p. This is h is a Planck's constant, p is a momentum of the particle. This is called de Broglie wavelength. De Broglie told that every particle who has a mass moving with some velocity will be associated with a wave. These waves are called de Broglie waves or matter waves. Now, let us see what are these de Broglie waves. Yes, so every material particle will be associated with wave and particle nature. For this theory, de Broglie got a Nobel Prize in 1929. He proposed this theory in 1924. In 1929, he was awarded Nobel Prize. And you can think of how good the thinking of Louis de Broglie. And this de Broglie hypothesis changed the entire world in terms of new inventions in the science and technology. You will see that in a short time. Now, let us consider this is a particle moving, which has a mass and moving with some velocity. Every particle who has a mass moving with some velocity will be associated with a wave. And this wave is called de Broglie wave. And this wavelength of the wave is given by lambda is equal to h by p. This is the de Broglie wavelength. Now, you might be very confused with the wave and a particle. How a particle can have wave? Let us consider this is a particle moving. Now, the wave will be simply look like this wave only. You can see here. Now, the particle is somewhere lying in this wave. And the particle can be here, or here, or here, or here, anywhere. Particle can be anywhere from here to here. Can be anywhere here. We cannot find where exactly particle is lying in this wave, in this de Broglie wave or a matter wave. So there will be some uncertainty in the finding the particle position. That uncertainty in the particle position is represented by delta x. That means in this kind of matter waves, the particle is lying in a wave, like this way somewhere. We don't know where the exactly particle is lying. So the uncertainty in finding the particle position is delta x. And the momentum, again, the momentum can be represented by p. At the same time, we cannot even find the momentum in this de Broglie wave accurately. So that means even in the case of momentum, there will be some uncertainty. So we can represent that one delta p. So this is the de Broglie wave. The de Broglie wave means every moving particle who has mass will be associated with a wave called de Broglie waves. And the wavelength of the wave is given by lambda is equal to h by p, which we can write h by mv. Now, in this wave, we cannot find exactly the position momentum. So there will be uncertainty in finding the position and momentum. So the product of these two, delta x into delta p, is greater than or equal to h by 4 pi. What is this principle called? This is called Heisenberg uncertainty principle. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle says that both the position and momentum of the particle cannot be measured simultaneously and accurately. So the product of delta x, that is a uncertainty in position and uncertainty in momentum, is greater than or equal to h by 4 pi. This is called Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Fine. Now, you might be confused how a person will have a wave nature. Though de Broglie told that every particle will be having both particle nature and wave nature. But how do you imagine that some person will have a wave nature. Let us see that. So, in this example, I'm going to calculate the de Broglie wavelength for a person, like you, me, and someone. Right? From this one, you will be able to understand that the de Broglie concept can be applied everywhere and in any particle. Let's see, we are trying to find out the de Broglie wavelength for a person. Person means a man. We know that the de Broglie wavelength lambda is equal to h by p, which can be written h by mv, because p is equal to mv, mass into velocity. So that means the person should be moving on with some velocity. So let us consider a particular example, a person who has a mass 75 kilograms is jogging with some velocity, that is 2.2 meters per second. Now, let us find out the de Broglie wavelength for this particular person who is jogging with 2.2 meters per second. So, simply take lambda is equal to h by mv. So, h you know, Planck's constant, mass of the person, velocity of the person. Let us substitute it. So, when we substitute, we get the answer, this one. If you simplify this again, we get answer 4.015 × 10⁻³⁶ meters. Very, very small. The wavelength of the person is 10⁻³⁶. Very, very small. Less than angstrom units. We cannot even measure it. We don't have any instrument to measure that. That means the wavelength is very small, so we cannot really observe the wavelength of a person who is moving with 2.2 meters per second, or who has a 75 kg, or someone who is a person. Let us also find out for a small particle, like electron. Now, we are trying to find out the de Broglie wavelength for an electron. Now, we know that the de Broglie wavelength, lambda is equal to h by mv. This is the same thing. So, m is the mass of the particle, v is the velocity of the particle. So, we are considering electron is moving with some velocity. In this example, we know that mass of the electron 9.1 × 10⁻³⁶ kg, this is a standard one. We are considering it is moving with some velocity 1.6 × 10⁶ meters per second. Now, apply these two in the de Broglie wavelength, that is here. Now we are substituting the Planck's constant value, mass of the electron, velocity of the electron. Now, if we calculate this one, we see 4.55 × 10⁻¹⁰ meters. That means simply 4.55 angstrom units, very small, but still we can measure it, we can look through that. But when we consider the wavelength of a person, it is of the order of 10⁻³⁶. If you see here, the person wavelength is of the order of 10⁻³⁶ meters. Compared to the wavelength of the electron, the person wavelength is very small. This is 10⁻¹⁰, this is 10⁻³⁶. Very, very small. That is the reason why we cannot see the wavelength of the wave nature of a person. If you see here, this is the 10⁻³⁶ meters, though if you wanted to draw the wavelength for this one is very small, so like this way. Like this way. You can see here, the wave is almost like a line. But if you see here, 4 angstrom units, so still you can see here some kind of wave will be there. If this length is of the order of at least some 6 angstrom units. Here also there is a wave nature, but you cannot determine it. But here there is a wave nature, and the wave nature can be prominent. And also you can see here, and the wavelength of this particle is comparable to the size of the electron. Electron size is also of the order of 1 Fermi or something like this. So, when the particle size is of the order of de Broglie wavelength, then their wave nature is most prominent. So, we will also have a wave nature, but that is very small. So, you won't find the wave nature of a person. Similar to a cricket ball. Even if you throw a cricket ball, you will see like a particle is moving, rather than a wave is moving. That is also because the wavelength is so small that it cannot be a prominent to visible to our eyes. But here, the electron's size is very small, so the wavelength can be observed very easily. So the wavelength is prominent in this case. Still, you have a problem? Now, let us see. To understand this more realistically, G.P. Thomson conducted an experiment to check whether electron has a wave nature or not. Let's see that. Now, did you remember that the diffraction experiment, what we did is, we have taken a light and sent through a pinholes. When we send the light through pinholes, what we do observe? We have observed a band, that is diffraction pattern. That means a bright fringes, dark fringes, bright fringes, dark fringes. If you send electrons also through a pinhole, if you observe the dark and bright fringes, then we can think that electrons also has a wave nature. So for that one, the G.P. Thomson considered, so this is the electron gun where the electrons are releasing. You can see here, the electrons are emitting from this electron gun. These are all electrons. That's the reason you can see silk particles are there. Now what we did is, there is a pinhole. Now the electrons are passing through this pinhole. This is the pinhole. Now, after passing through this pinhole electrons, if they are particles, you will see only just that kind of one or two bands. But now, when electrons are passing through this pinhole, surprisingly, we can see a kind of bright dark fringes here. You can see here, it will come here now. Yes, this is the one. You can see here, bright fringe, dark fringe, bright fringe, dark fringe. This is only observed when the incoming things are behaves like a waves, similar to like a diffraction of light waves. That means when you observe a diffraction pattern like this, that confirms that the electrons has a wave nature. And it is exactly following de Broglie's hypothesis. That is the reason why de Broglie got a Nobel Prize. Okay, fine. Now with this experiment, you might understand that electrons has a wave nature. So what? What is the use of these electrons if they have a wave nature or particle nature? Doesn't matter to you, right? No, it matters to us. It leads technologically, a lot of inventions are happened. You will see the technological importance of this invention here. Normally, what do you think this? This is the surface of some material. Normally, the optical microscope can give you a magnification of few thousands X. X means you are actually zooming and looking at it. But if you see here, if you make a microscope with electrons, you can see here, we can magnify 30,000 times. After 30,000 times magnifying, that means 30,000 X zooming, you will see the surface of some material. Can you see anything? No. Now, what we can do, we choose this small area and again zoom. It looks like this. Now, can you imagine at what magnification we are? We are at 150,000 times. 150,000 X. That means 150,000 times we zoomed into the material and seeing it. Now, this material look like this way. You can also see other orientation of the same thing. You can see nice, beautiful hexagonal structures. This is visible only by using electron microscopes. That means the microscopes which are made with electrons as a source, not light. That is the invention that was given by de Broglie hypothesis. Right? So, this kind of nanostructures are visible only when we have electron microscopes. So, that is important. We cannot see these kind of nanostructures using a normal light microscopes, optical microscopes. Now, we will see the properties of these de Broglie waves or matter waves. Now, you know that if any particle is having a mass moving with some velocity, it will have a wave. And the wavelength of this wave is given by lambda is equal to h by mv, which is h by p. Now let us see the properties of these matter waves. Those are, the first one is, the lighter the particle, the greater the wavelength of associated with. Simply, if the mass of the particle is smaller, then the wavelength is larger. The lighter the particle, that means the particle mass is very small, then the wavelength is greater, that means it's a larger, inversely proportional. That is, lambda is inversely proportional to mass of the particle. Simply. Second one is, smaller is the velocity, that means the velocity is small for a particular particle, then we can expect the wavelength is larger. Simply, from this same equation, lambda is inversely proportional to velocity of the particle. If the velocity is small, then we get wavelength is larger. Then the third one is, if velocity is zero, if the particle is not moving, that means the particle is at rest, then the wavelength associated with this is infinite, because v is equal to zero, then lambda is infinite. What is the meaning of this? Normally, what you say wavelength, for example, if you see, this is a one wavelength of a particular wave. If lambda is infinite, means what is the meaning of this? So infinite wavelength means it is rising and it is going, keep on going until infinite. That means it has lost its wave character. It's no more wave, it's a straight line. So that means if the particle is at rest, then the wavelength is infinity, means there is no wave character. So the de Broglie waves won't be there for a particle is at rest. Then if v is infinite, then lambda tends to zero. That means if the velocity is larger, then the wavelength is closer to zero. What is the meaning of this? For example, that is, the waves are produced by the motion of the particles. The meaning of this one is, we know that the wavelength is this one. Now, if the wavelength is becoming small, what is meaning of this? You will see, like, this is a propagation direction. The smaller wavelength means like this way. It's almost like a line. It's almost like a line because the wavelength is smaller. It's almost like a line. That means it behaves like a particle. So if v tends to infinite, its velocity is very high, then you will still see like a particles, like a velocity, like a photons. Photons has the highest velocity. So you see like a particles. And another thing is, the velocity of matter wave depends upon the velocity of the material particle. The velocity of the matter wave depends upon the velocity. How much is the velocity of a particle? Then the velocity of the matter wave depends upon the velocity of the material. And the sixth one is, matter waves are not electromagnetic waves. This is very, very important. Matter waves are not electromagnetic waves. They are not electromagnetic waves. Electromagnetic waves means this is the propagation direction, and there will be electric field, and there will be magnetic field perpendicular to propagation direction. They're both oscillating and carrying energy. This is a electromagnetic wave. But the matter waves are not electromagnetic waves. They are generating when the particle, a material particle, is in motion. So the matter waves or de Broglie waves are not electromagnetic waves. They are independent of charge. Or matter waves are only giving for a photons or electrons. What about neutrons? Neutrons also will have a matter waves. So the matter waves are independent of charge. That means the matter waves can be generated for both charged particles and a neutral particles. So they are independent of charges. Even electron is moving can produce a matter waves. Neutron is moving can produce a matter waves. Proton is moving can also produce a matter waves. So for both charged particles and neutral particles, if they are in motion, you get a matter waves. And they are not electromagnetic waves. Now, you know that they exhibit diffraction like other waves. We have already seen that electrons are exhibiting a diffraction pattern, so that we confirm that the electrons has a wave nature. So that means electrons are producing matter waves, they are diffracting. So matter waves exhibits diffraction properties like other waves. So this is important. So these are the some of the properties. Let's see summary of this class. Electromagnetic radiation has a dual nature, that means both the particle nature and wave nature. And every moving particle, according to de Broglie, this is the de Broglie hypothesis and the definition, every moving particle who has a mass is associated with a wave called matter waves or de Broglie waves. Every moving particle who has a mass and moving with some velocity will be associated with a wave. Those waves are called de Broglie waves. And the wavelength of the de Broglie wave is given by lambda is equal to h by p or h by mv. P is a momentum, we can write m into v, mass into velocity. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle and the matter wave, the particle will be lying at somewhere in the wave. So we cannot determine the exactly position of the particle and momentum of the particle instantaneously at any time. So both the position and momentum of an object cannot be measured simultaneously accurately at the same time. So this is being given by Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Thank you for your attention. See you again.